Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Camera Tuesday. In today's episode we're going to talk about RED cameras. So let's dive right into it. Now, so what is this RED Digital Cinema? Basically, it's a company created in USA in 1999 and it's basically 20 years old, and their first product that was launched to the public was RED One. Now, it was introduced in 2007. So you might be like, okay, what the hell they were doing? There were a lot of fundamental research they had to do, basically figuring out multiple pipelines and all that, creating specific format. So they were doing that behind doors, and in 2007, the product came out. Now, this may look small, but it is very big. Because of the design, it looks small. It is very big and very heavy. It was using iron back in that day. So it was very big and heavy. And in 2015, they became the first company to release a 8K cinema camera. Other companies have tried that, but the grades don't line up. So basically in 2015, they cracked that 8K code, and the sensor size is basically bigger than 35 millimeter super, basically the cinema format that we are used to, basically super 35. It's bigger than that. It's a Venta Vision or something like that. It was used for Star Wars original series. So it's much, it's definitely bigger. It's basically, rather than like this, it's like this. So is much bigger than that. So why though so much hype? It's a cinema camera. So why the hell every Tom, Dick and Harry on every single forum, from YouTube to Facebook and everywhere, is talking about RED cameras? Now think of it this way. Before RED came along, it's not like RED is the first company to make a digital cinema camera. Digital production camera was already on the way, and digital broadcasting cameras were already taking the market. So, but cinema, they were still holding on to the film. So basically they were still using actual film, and there were some directors that to this day still hold on to film, like Christopher Nolan and other people like that. So Zack Snyder also likes film. So film was hanging on to, even though digital reached the point. However, there was no mainstream adoption of that. This company alone pushed it. They did not meet it. There were like, things were happening, or even if RED Apex was removed from the timeline, it will still happen. It would happen slowly, but they pushed it, they turbocharged it. Now, the sole reason this happened is basically because RED was a small company, and when they started, they went for the moon. Basically, they went as high resolution as possible. To think of it in this way, even though many movie cameras are capable of 4K, they generally don't do 4K, simply because the cinema industry does not need that. So many Bollywood movies, many Hollywood movies are still captured in 2K, basically a full HD. It's a bit bigger than full HD. So 2K DCI, digital cinema interframe, and that is generally used for everything that you see most of the time. Very few times you will have a pipeline that is completely 4K. Very few movies have that. One of the popular pictures is Gone Girl, that was like, okay, true 4K was used. So the 4K Blu-ray that you receive of the old pictures, like any picture that is made in around 2010 to 2015, they are generally upscaled from 2K Master. Now that 2K Master is such a high bit rate that it is more than good enough. Like you have to understand, there is a point of diminishing return with resolution also. So same way you can easily tell the difference between a mono sound and stereo sound, you can't tell that easily, like from stereo to 5.1, especially if you have headphones, it makes it difficult. And you, most people can't tell the difference from 5.1, good 5.1, to basically other formats that are there, like 10.5, 10.2, and the three-dimensional space that is now being used right now. So point of diminishing return also happens from basically from SD video, that what we used to use in our handycams and all that, from that to full HD, that was a mind-boggling jump. But from full HD to 4K, basically 2K to 4K, it's not that big of a jump. It's not like, whoa. So many companies stuck to 2K, and almost all digital cinema projection is still 2K. Only few are true 4K, and even in IMAX, they basically use either film, or most of the time if the IMAX is using digital system, it is still 2K. However, IMAX digital laser projection system goes up to 4K. So in those scenarios, you can understand that 4K is not as universal as you would think. There is, you are more likely to find 4K content on YouTube than you are in Hollywood. So even though 4K is still not mainstream, they started to release 4K at 60 frames per second in 2007. Now 4K is a big deal, because if you have 4K footage, that allows you to a lot of creative control. Basically, let's say your camera is a little bit tilted, you can fix it in 4K. Let's say this is very commonly done in movie, TV show like like House of Cards, because House of Cards wants to demonstrate power with the characters, so they generally make sure the character is absolutely center, like absolutely center. So they will try to get the actor as close as possible, camera as centered as possible. When they capture it, there is always will be some wiggle room. But when you are in computer and you can be like, okay, stretch to 100%, then you draw a grid and you can easily align it. So this little tweaks makes it much more appealing, much more like absolute. So many people enjoy that aspect, and in terms of CG and all that, they also enjoy the fact that you have not lot more data to do motion tracking. That is also helpful. So that is why 4K became popular, even though it's not used, like final delivery, that final digital film that is sold to the basically theaters and all that, they are still 2K master, but it's more than good enough. So, and if you have 4K input, you can directly crop and do whatever you want to do, pan, tilt, all that. So that is why 4K became so popular with the cinema industry. However, that 60 frame per second did not become so useful for the cinema. It became very useful for music industry, because many times music videos, if you have paid attention to them, they have slow motion sometimes, and they don't have slow motion that requires you to buy a phantom camera where you can go 1000 frame per second or 10,000 frame per second. Most of the time they don't do that. However, they need subtle bit of slow motion and all that. 60 frame per second is more than good enough for that. It like it's a 2x slower, and especially if you have basically music video or light action and all that, especially like two people fighting and you don't have the budget or you don't want to, you can easily like that's almost 3x slowdown, because you are going from 60 to 24. So that also became very popular, and this is at 4K in 2007. You have to understand, the camera can do upwards of 100 to 120 in full HD. So the movie industry did not accept it right away. However, the basically production industry that was specifically dealing with music videos, they ran with it, and the people who are doing advertisements, they ran with it. So this is how RED started to spread around. Now in 2008, and basically Valentine's Day, February 14, Jumper, the movie released, and this is the first movie that was shot in RED, according to RED website itself. Now after this, RED was like sold everywhere, although this movie flopped, but the camera quality was like established, that you can actually have a full 200 inch projection and it will still look good. So that was established and people started to use on. Now right now RED is like, you have to look hard to find a place where nobody is using RED. So Game of Thrones was shot on RED, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 was shot on RED. So you have to understand, RED has become synonymous with quality. And does it have quality? Short answer, yes. Like if you buy a RED camera, no matter what complaints you will have, you will never have complaint about the fact that it has crappy image quality. All the complaints you can have, complaint that does not have best low light performance, because if you want best low light performance that money can buy, the best still to this day is still Sony Mark II, because it has like full frame sensor and it is only 12 megapixels, so it literally can see in the dark. So removing that sensor, basically in cinema industry, no camera comes even close to this. Basically in terms of dynamic range, this is mind-bogglingly awesome. And in terms of feel, like, because you have to understand, most of the feel, look and feel comes from the lens, but again, lens is compiling the light, is still drawing the light on the sensor still colors your final output. The final output of RAW is very dramatic. So basically, if you have to understand it this way, think of it this way: if you want Zack Snyder kind of feel, movie 300 or Batman versus Superman, something like dark, dramatic, you will enjoy RED, because RED has that kind of feel to it. Like, this is one of the easy way you can tell whether this movie, not movie, like if untampered file, because if there is a good colorist, he can do that. That's the whole point of RAW file. But if you take just a direct RAW, apply a basic color correction to it, and tada, the RED epic footage will always look like a bit more dramatic. So people who want to do science fiction like Guardians of the Galaxy, they enjoy that. People who want to use a lot of motion tracking and cinematic benefit, they will enjoy that. However, let's say you're doing a romantic movie and you want like things to have a bit more feel to it, bit more touch to it, you will look at Alexa Miri. So at this point, this is why the hype is there. It's basically changed the whole Hollywood slowly over time. However, the music industry that directly went from trying to take basically film to directly digital because of this, because that's 60 frame per second and 120 at full HD. So this became the reason for hype. And the fact that you can say this was used for Game of Thrones, the fact that you can say it was used for Guardians of the Galaxy, that's more than enough. Now, so what is the real world aspect of it? Okay, that's the movie industry, that's the industry, but not individual level. So what happened to real world? Basically, it's half the price. That's the whole point. That's why it got so many people into the door. Basically, it's like this. Many times you must have seen prices rated as like $7,999. Now it's $8,000, but they never say $8,000, they say $7,000, because your brain will always shorthand it. So like, oh, it's a 7K, something like that happened with this. So this was like almost half the price of other competitive cameras, and in terms of resolution it was unmatched. So like, if you have to figure out the what is the motto of RED cameras, the motto is high resolution and high frame rate. They never compromise on those things. Like, they will never release a camera that cannot do 60 frames per second. You can easily find many cinema cameras that have been used and continuously being used, they still don't have 60 frames per second. These puppies are completely opposite of that. It's like, we're gonna give you as high resolution as possible, we're gonna give you as high frame rate as possible. That's their motto. Now they employ a modular design. Now some people love it, some people hate it, but the idea is this also helped RED to spread around everywhere, because nowadays gimbals are becoming much more affordable, camera cranes are becoming much more affordable, drones are starting to play a big role. So in those sort of scenarios, having a small camera really important. So RED, given the fact that it's a completely modular system, like they don't even come with their own display system. Basically, you can't use this. If you buy this, you can't use this. You have to buy a lot of other things to use it. So in those sort of scenario, the modularity actually helps them. Basically, they will have a power cable, a lens, that's it. And they will try to do everything over the Wi-Fi system and all that. So that is why they can they are so beloved by so many people. It's like, if you have a small gimbal, a gimbal directly has an exponential cost. So basically, if you ask someone, hey, give me a gimbal that can handle, let's say, 2 to 3 kilos, okay. Gimbal that can handle 10 kilos, okay. Gimbal that can handle 15 to 20 kilos, the price is like ludicrous at that point. So that is why this became very famous with YouTube, because the vlogging market, they needed something compact and small. This had a starting point that was so compact and small, especially in drone industry. This was like very easy. Like, there are drones that can lift very heavy things, but they will cost more. So this really started to change the industry slowly. That's why there's so much, every Tom, Dick and Harry talks about this. Now, if it has such a good image quality, if it has such a grand reach in Hollywood and Bollywood, is everything rosy? No. Well, it has some dark sides. Now, the biggest dark side that I find is basically it is way too complex. You can't just go to Malika. You can do that. It's just not an easy function where it's like, okay, click this and buy this. You have to basically figure out what body is. Because they are modular, they went modular too deep. Too deep, that simply means basically now they are selling bodies and sensors separately. Now, of course, you can't buy it. The sensor and body separately is basically there are basically same way you buy DSLR with kit lenses is something like that. So you can buy same body with two sensors. Basically, you can get a Monstro 8K, which is Venta, that bigger format, as you can see, it's a much bigger format, or you can buy 8K sensor, which is Super 35mm. So you can say both are 8K, both are from RED, both of them have the same quote-unquote brain, basically the processing aspect of it, but the sensor is different. So the idea with this was basically you will buy how RED is releasing thing is like sensor, body, sensor, body, sensor. They are doing this alternately. So the idea is you can buy a body and you can change the sensor in the future. So this creates a problem. This basically creates a camera which is very noisy, because the thermal management of every sensor is completely different. So you have to overbuild it. You have to be like, okay, let's say this guy is like right now buy a 5K sensor, and it's like, okay, every he's like, okay, I'm only gonna work about like 4K. So 5K is more than good enough. I bought 5K sensor, but they have to design the body in such a way that what if they put the bigger sensor, bigger 8K sensor, it still should be able to cool it. Side effect, the heat sinks were no longer adequate, so they will turbocharge the fans speed. So this is the difficult aspect of it. So almost everybody is like comfortable with the idea, okay, battery is modular, the time code, for time code input you have to buy another plate, for this and that you have to buy so many things to make it useful, okay. But the fact that you are splitting sensor and processor separately, that was like okay, that's like you are now trying too hard. So that may become an issue if you are trying to buy something. Now that itself is like, okay, that's their choice, that they're, but they went to scam length. Basically they became like a scammer when they released the RED mini mags. Before the first RED camera there was, it had like a normal C-fast storage system, but this they started. So everybody at first thought, okay, this must be a proprietary hoo-ha that is like, so fast and all that. But quickly people noticed when they were connecting this to the dock was only giving like 600 Mbps, even though dock supposed to give you like much higher rate because it was connected to USB 3.0. Or some people connected like with Thunderbolt. So why the heck it was not? Somebody opened it up and he's like, okay, it's just M.2 SATA. M.2 SATA, and you might be like, okay, this adapter might be fancy. No, it's not fancy. It's basically direct connect adapter. Nothing here like, you know, changes. Like you can directly solder each other and it won't have any issue. So all the resistor and capacitor you see, these are what we call ground filter. I have provided the video down below where you can see this guy made the video, I think 2 weeks ago. And like literally he takes the SSD out, changes the SSD, changes the firmware on the SSD to prove that aspect that, you know, there is custom firmware. There is nothing fancy like that. So you have to understand, this is a scam. And the why I'm calling it a scam is because they are calling 512 gigabytes. The original system barely had 480, because like M-SATA does not come with like 500 capacity. It only comes to 490. So once that was exposed, now they are like, now you can't buy 1 terabyte. It will be like 960, because that is direct mislabeling. They tampered with the firmware, so the computer will not show you. Computer, I'm saying basically the camera will not show you that it's a 400 or all that. So this is a flat out scam. And this also causes another factor, because there is so much extra interface, extra resistance and extra hoo-ha, the mounting issue is one of the very prominent thing that you have to face with RED systems. Basically, RED's quality control is not as high as people would think. Now, given the fact that you are spending $10,000 to $50,000 to sometimes almost reaching $100,000, it's not that high in terms of quality. Basically, it does not mean that you buy a RED camera, okay, it's gonna stop working. But you can easily check on almost all YouTubers. They are like, yeah, I bought this in less than 1 or 2 years, I had issue. And sometimes the issue could be very frustrating, specifically with this Max. It's like, yeah, card not detected. And so if you are serious about buying a RED camera, I would urge you to just buy a smallest capacity and then just change the micro SD. It will save you so much money. You can buy so much good lens with that. So this is the aspect where it's like, yeah, I can understand why they are scamming it, because you have to understand they are a very small company, quote unquote, compared to RE or other things like that. And they do not even have a large enough what you call warehouse and, you know, repair infrastructure. In India, you can easily find a basically storehouse where you can get your RE repaired to some level. Of course, they're not gonna remove the sensor and fix the sensor if sensor is broken, but they can do a very large extent. In RED, the only option the RED service center will give you is, yeah, we are sending it out. It will take you to 2 to 3 weeks to get your things done if you're lucky. So you have to understand that the reliability issue makes it a very cheap proposition. For some people it's okay. Sometimes they like mini movie sets sometimes have double RED cameras just as a backup. Now that's a good thing to do. People used to do that even with film cameras. However, if you're doing practical effects, you can't get that luxury. And the fact that they only allow you to use one SSD, not even like don't give us raw output. Okay, I can understand raw output will be too difficult. Okay, give us 2 card slots. That's frustrating. That's a very difficult thing to do. Blackmagic does that, Canon does that, Sony does that. They are the only company that's like, yeah, no backup. Now, does that translate to people losing? Think of it this way. If you check out basically Oscar list, basically how many how many movies went inside, and you check the list, first few will be like film cameras, and then there will be RE, and then last 2-3 would be RED cameras. Because if you are doing practical effects, RED cameras are very serious risk. Now again, does this mean it will like by default you buy it, it will not work? No, most of the time it will work, but you have to be aware of that. Like there are many people who are taking RED cameras to CES show floor, and you can easily see around. There are many YouTube videos of it. Like, yeah, in CES it stopped working. The card is not working. Now, of course, it still works. Like you can restart it and all that. Just the uptime on such a expensive device is not matching the quality expected. So QC on these devices really need to push up. Like it's just not good enough. So that is the one thing that you have to be thoroughly aware of. Like if you are risking a very expensive shoot, figure out a way to like extract raw out of it or have something, because otherwise like it could happen. Like it's very unlikely, but it could happen. And people are complaining like in 6 to 7 months they are SSD, yeah, they are replacing it, but SSD that is dying in 6 to 7 months, it's like, dude, something must be wrong in that. So there is some dark side to RED Epic. Like image quality is badass, the name recognition is badass. Other than that, everything else is like, are you serious? Like this was a scam. Now you can check it out. Like in RED itself video, they never say 512 or 1 terabyte. Now they are like, yeah, it's like 484, 490 or 960 gigabyte. Because if they said terabyte, they will get lawsuited. So there are some dark side to it. So specifically with the scam aspect of the drives, and this will affect you. But the other aspect, the reliability is very touchy right now. So this was my presentation on RED Epic cameras. I hope you liked it, learned from it. In that case, please click the like button. If you didn't like it, don't learn from it. I would urge you to press dislike. I would urge you to press it twice to show me your extra disappointment. And please leave a comment, because I reply to all of them. Watch all these videos, subscribe, press the bell icon if you're free. And as always, thanks for watching.